name is Predrag Knezevic. I work for DataStax and DSE team, mostly on improving build experience, build processes, and the internal test infrastructure we use for testing DSE product. In today's talk, I'm going to share with you our experience towards building efficient testing infrastructure, which can be used for running our tests in an efficient way in order to assure the quality of the product. So it's the 21st century. I don't think we need to particularly talk about the importance of automated tests. So we do that automation since early 90s already, and developers are used to it, to write tests. But in practice, when you start with a clean greenfield project, the beginning, you have not significant number of tests. So the tests are added as you are adding new features, you're discovering new bugs, and do some regression testing. And everything is fine and good until we reach some point that the number of tests increase so much that this influences your feedback cycles. So in essence, the total testing time will go beyond the scope, which is really appropriate and good for developers to cope with. On the other side, in recent years, you have like a more push or pressure from the business side, saying that they want to have a product which is always releasable, which means that in any point in time, they can cut the release and go to the market because the pressure in the market is minimal, so high, they need to have more room for doing better business decisions. And this goes in the direction of continuous testing. So developers and engineers said, okay, we need to do much more frequently testing and to do really good test rounds in order to assure that the quality of the product is always good. So this boils down practically in practice. So we need to run our tests, and not only unit tests. We are speaking here about the tests which can actually measure the quality of the product, which means a lot of functional tests, a lot of integration tests, very frequently. So maybe in the beginning of 2000 and something, it was okay to run your tests once a night or once a week in order to figure out where you stand. But now it's really important that you can run your test on each pre-merge check in order to figure out if your release branches are still okay, if you didn't hurt consistency stuff, if you didn't break any tests, if you didn't open any regressions again. So, but at the other side, in order to satisfy developers or engineers, you need to keep those testing rounds short. So developers do not want to wait many hours to get a feedback. They want to close the issue, they're going to merge issue, and then if you don't have a good infrastructure to support that, then you start to decrease developer experience in your organization. So, and the other important thing is, so when you run your test and you get some failures, you want to have this kind of repeatability. So you want to ensure that when there is a bug, there is a failure, the developer can come and run those tests again in order to fix the bug, to debug stuff, and simply to understand what's going on. As you can imagine, we were in DSC, we're not immune to the problems I just described. So somewhere by the end of 2014, we end up with our testing grounds with all of optimization, all the hacks we could do on Jenkins. They were like taking approximately 5 hours to complete, right? And this is not something which is really nice for developers again. So they, and then we started, of course, when you have such large rounds, then you start hacking in a way. You start to think what else I need to really run on every pre-merge check. What could be dropped out? What could be run nightly? What could be run weekly? And usually, we humans, we cannot judge good about this. So we're going to leave out some tests, which going to fail soon, but we will not notice. And then after a while, when we run our weekly tests, we discover that we need to dig up, dig in, into commit logs to find out what the commit caused that in order to fix that, and the developers, again, they are starting to feel unhappy. And we needed to do something about it. So very, in a few, month or so, we moved from Ant, our build system, to Gradle. And we managed to address the issues we had. So now, depending on the DSE version where we run tests, our test rounds take like between 40 and 60 minutes to complete. We have, in meanwhile, 16 hours testing time. Also, starting from 4.7 version, so compared to version 5.0, the number of our tests doubled, and we are still able to run them in much shorter time than before. And we ensure that we have a stable environment, a repeatable environment, so that our developers are much happier now again. They can run the tests locally. They can spot the problems, debug easily, and the environments are the same across the all machines involved in testing. So this talk is really not about how to build a good testing plan, what to test, or how to write fast tests. It's more about when you have already some test base, and you have faster or slower tests, how to run them efficiently in order to support your developers to that they still have good experience. So we have chosen Gradle. There are many reasons why we did that. So, but for the scope of this talk, one in particular feature was very important. So namely, the Gradle has out-of-the-box a feature to run the test in parallel. And this was really something what we were looking for previously on the Ant, so Ant doesn't have this kind of feature, so all JUnit tests were executed sequentially, so you couldn't actually use all the power you have on your modern hardware. And when we moved to Gradle, then running tests on Gradle started to look like this. For developers, for continuous integration, for any machine involved in the process. So you simply run your test task, or if you want to do just a particular test class, then you specify it on the command line. But by default, Gradle has this feature turned off for various reasons. So you end up in this kind of execution workflow where you have a Gradle main process, and then you have one test worker which has a test classes in the queue, and they're going to be processed sequentially. If you look in the Gradle documentation, so turning this feature on is relatively easy. So you just need to specify number of test workers you want to run in parallel. And you get this kind of workflow. Now, one would say we're done, so everything's fine. But since we have a lot of, it's not just about unit tests, so we have a lot of functional tests, a lot of integration tests, so we start, some clusters, starting from one node cluster to three, four node cluster in our tests, they open some ports, etc. We get a lot of collisions. So actually, those test workers are running on the same machine, they are like separate processes, but again, there is no isolation in between. So they are all attacking the same ports, same network interfaces, and you cannot run your test like that. At least not, you cannot run your functional tests. So we need to do something about it. So we need to isolate somehow our workers in order to be able to use the power we have under the hood, but again, not to modify production code, but because we are also integrating a lot of third-party libraries, so you don't actually know what could cause a collision. Maybe there is some, they're going to use the same path on the file system. They're going to open some ports you're not aware of at all. So let's try to minimize our effort. So, and what we did. So what about if we isolate test workers in Docker containers and run our test there? Sounds very easy. And it turns out that it was not really hard to implement that. So we implemented a dedicated Gradle plugin for that. The plugin is open source. You can use it in any project if you want. And by having that, we have achieved the full isolation. So you can now run your tests. You can spin up some clusters inside of Docker container. There is no collision. And you could start enjoying really the speed you get. Besides that, so the bootstrapping on any machine which is only testing is relatively easy. So you need just to install Docker, so natively, or if you are under Mac, you have a boot to Docker, or even Linux, you can use boot Docker images. There is no change to production or test code. Everything works as before. And you got really consistent test environment. So they are consistent across all machines. There is no more excuse, it works on my machine, but doesn't work on a CI, because all developers can run tests against the same Docker container, or Docker image. And those Docker images are already pre-configured, so you manage them inside of Docker files. You put also in your code repository. So you can say, okay, I need a test environment which has installed Java 8, or Java 7, or Java 9. I need to have some cryptographic extensions, that's fine. You can have other tools you required for your testing, and you can simply run your test against inside those particular Docker image or cellular test environments. So you can simply run your test against Java 7, Java 8, Java 9, and you can figure out if something is not working depending on the JDK you use. So are we done? So now we have, like, we can run things in parallel. Are we getting really the best performances we could get, or the shortest testing times? Unfortunately, it turned out that the Gradle implementation of this test execution is not really optimal. So namely, what they do, they pre-allocate, so each of the worker has a test queue, and they pre-allocate, they fill up the queues at the beginning of testing phase. So simply, in some random manner or iterative manner, they just populate the testing queues. What does it mean in practice? So it can happen, and it happens actually very often. The duration of different tests is different, so this is really not uniform. And you have some test classes which take, let's say, a couple of minutes, others are taking just a couple of seconds. At the end of the testing round, we have test workers which are with empty queues and doing nothing, but they could do something if they had some tests in the queue, but they finish their jobs. Whereas there are some test workers which have already still some test classes to process. And this kind of effect makes that the testing rounds are still taking much more time than they should or could. So one improvement we did in this Gradle plugin was to have just one queue, which sits on the main process. And then the workers just pick test classes from the queue when they're idle. Yeah? Sounds simple, but then are we still in optimal area? No, because the order of the queue is really random. So duration of the test round really depends how the test classes are sorted there, because you can have like really different, and duration test round depends on the order in the test queue. So what could we do more? Well, we could try to do some scheduling. This is something not really new stuff. It comes from the area of job scheduling of multi-core machines, but it's an MP-hard problem. If you want to do it properly, it's MP-hard. There are some approximations. The most used algorithm for building the queues is called LPT, so longest processing time. So you sort your durations, and then you simply start from the longest one, and then you just put them in queues, which are, by that point, the shortest one. And you get kind of a good execution time. But in order to do that, you need to have a history of previous test rounds. So it's kind of drawback. You have to decide whether you want to do that, where you're going to keep your histories, how you're going to manage them, what kind of history you want to actually use for the current round, and so on. But what else we can do? Of course, we can throw more power into the game. So imagine that you have more powerful machines, so it's like 24, 32 cores, you can get some speed, right? So you just spin up more workers and you're good. But those machines are expensive, actually, and you would like to try to use some cheaper hardware for that. There is another approach. You can actually, since you're already using Docker to wrap up your test workers, you can actually use Docker Swarm. So you can build up a cluster of Docker machines, and the interface you're talking to is the very same you have by the regular Docker nodes, but this time Swarm Master is taking care about distributing your test workers on an appropriate machine, spinning them up, and collecting results back. And this, with our Gradle plugin, works really transparently. You can just simply set up the cluster. You point your Gradle plugin to the particular Docker Swarm. You build images, and you just run your test. And with that, you can actually scale up or down depending on your needs. You can add more machines. You have like hundreds of workers which run your tests in parallel. But even then, no matter how many workers you throw in the game, you're still bounded. And your lower bound is equal to duration of the slowest test class. Imagine that you have an infinite number of test workers. If you have a class which duration is, let's say, 5 minutes, and all other classes are below that, your test round cannot be shorter than 5 minutes because it has to complete. In order to move forward, all these changes, all these things were without touching production or test code. If we want to go below that, we need to at least touch test code in some manner. So what we need to do, imagine that you have this 5 minute long test class which contains a couple of tests. You want to break it up in a couple of test classes in order to increase throughput. You can do it manually by grouping test methods according to some fixture you use, or you can even say do some kind of bytecode manipulation. We had some experiment with that to annotate the class with particular annotation. Then you can simply, in an automatic manner, create multiple classes and putting a couple of methods in each of the test class, and with that you're going to increase your throughput. Also, what is important not to forget, grouping test classes into JUnit suite is really a bad practice, because in the JUnit test suite, all the classes run sequentially, no matter how many cores or workers you have. Simply, this is a property of JUnit framework. Can we do something more? Yeah, we could actually. We have some expensive resources we create for our tests. Namely, these are like clusters of DSE nodes. There is some time involved in bootstrapping them and shutting them down. And like with any, let's say, relational database before, so this is kind of expensive resources you want to not create so often. And you can do the same stuff with the DSE cluster. You can create them once, and then you can use them across the tests, in multiple tests, without need to create them many times. But in order to do that, you need to avoid having embedded DSE nodes in your tests. It's possible to start a node within the same JVM where your test is, but if you want to have like a multi-node configuration there, it's kind of tricky. We were doing that, and we were experiencing a lot of problems. Namely, in order to first boot such kind of configuration, you need to separate those nodes with different class loaders. Then you have still problems when you are shutting down such nodes, because the JVM didn't shut down, so there are some threads which are still hanging around. Some ports are sometimes not closed, and so on. So it's much cleaner if you really start your nodes in separate process. So shutting down is relatively easy. You can even kill your process, so without trying to be friendly, and so on. But there is another issue with that. So sometimes you really need to run some code, testing code on a node itself in order to check some internal state, or you have some integration test which really doesn't require talking to API or using client and so on. And since you have moved your node into separate process, there is a issue how I'm going to run my code on the remote side. We have quite a good experience with two libraries. One is third party called Mobility RPC. It's also freely available. And the other, a library we wrote by ourselves. So it's a kind of remote JUnit test runner. It allows you to define a regular JUnit test class. And when you annotate it just with a proper annotation, this test class will be executed on a remote side. So pretty easy. Instead of doing this manually, sending code via some serialization format and executing there, you can have a pretty decent and JUnit test class which looks like any other. And this particular JUnit runner supports really any existing JUnit runners on the remote side. You can have like a standard one, you have a parametrized, so there is an open source project which allows you to have like parametrized tests. You can run your Spock test if you want, you can run suites, whatever you want. One important aspect of our testing effort is to simulate some situation where you have some issues in the system. Say there are some weird edge situations you cannot simply test or simulate or trigger by regular usage, like there are some network delays, there are some exceptions occurring when you are asking for some service and so on. There is one very good library which can support you in these efforts. It's from JBoss called Byteman. And this library can help you to inject at runtime arbitrary failures, so exceptions, delays, pauses, whatever you really need in your tests. And with this library, we were able in very efficiently way to test some really edge cases without need to construct big fixtures. And all these efforts, all these things I mentioned until now was really towards writing some good tests or executing those tests in a short time. But imagine you have develop this infrastructure. You run your test on each pull request, and you get failures in report. So how are you going to now? So developers, of course, can run those tests locally. But how are you going to support your developer in an easy way to discover what's going on in the system? Of course, you have logging on, right? But usually, in the production, you're gonna write your log statements in a one particular single log file, say. And this doesn't really work for testing, because imagine now you have one single file where all the tests are writing their log statements. So you have like a really spaghetti or mixture of log statements, and you don't know what log statement belongs to what test case. So you need to help developers. And one approach is simply to split your log files per test file. So for each test, you're going to have a dedicated log file. And for each node in the cluster, you can identify that this node has produced this particular log statement. And then it's relatively easy. Then you can simply go and look what are the messages you got there, and you can easily figure out what was going wrong in the system. In order to establish this kind of feature, so we are anyway based on logback in our production cases, but we needed to simply to mark when the test starts and when the test ends. And we needed also to develop kind of infrastructure which sends the log statements to a particular central place, and on the receiver side, on the server side, then this demultiplexing occurs. So, and then this receiver can decide to what test file we're going to write which log statement. And also, additional advantage of this effort is that we could also analyze the log statements. Additionally, for some other errors, for example, we could scan our, log files in order to find net leaks and then fail appropriate tests. I'm going to show you just very quickly how this kind of infrastructure looks like in our infrastructure. So this is like a logback configuration file for the sender, which means usually a node in a cluster or test JVM. And you can simply specify the logback server where you want to when you want to send your messages, and debug level. Basically, that's it. We use asynchronous appender in order to just lower the pressure or the real threads in the node. And then on the receiver or router side, you receive all your events, and then you, based on some discriminator, there you decide what is the log file you're gonna really write your log statements. Yeah. And in order to figure out when is the test start and the test end, you can use the standard JUnit feature, which calls the rules, in order to implement such a rule, which can actually catch the beginning and the end of the test. And then you can have some also additional features at the end of the test which fails. You can generate thread dumps, which can all additionally help our developers to find out what the problem was. So this is the end of my talk. I would like just to summarize what we have achieved. So based on the open source technologies we were able to speed up our testing rounds to the point that our developers are really running them on each pull request and for multiple pull requests for the same feature at once. All the components and libraries are freely available. I believe that the approach we took is really applicable to any project in any organization, because there is nothing particular DSE inside. So if you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer. And I would like to thank you for attention. Now, the question is, so if Docker doesn't have already something like that embedded, they don't have that. No.
Have you been in communication with them about, hey, this is out there?
Well, it's on a plugin portal, so you can easily find it. Also, I have reported the plugin on their forum. They are aware of it. I mean, they are pretty popular is the plugin meanwhile, so you have a lot of downloads. So, yeah. That's not one way to do it. So I think Gradle people had some idea to do some kind of distributed testing in some clusters, but they'd never ever published anything in that direction so far.
Different options to have to sort of do an integration test with those.
Well, the question, the real issue is, what do you understand under a real cluster? In Dockerized, when you Dockerize a cluster or a, say node, right? You can have, you can build up just as regular cluster as with Vagrant. The advantage of this is that the footprint is way lower to bootstrap such machines, to stop clustering and so on. Compared to Vagrant, right? So I would say Vagrant is not the way to go, because you need to, I mean, the building such machines and managing such images is way complicated than making this happen in Docker. You have Docker file, which actually describes your environment, your say machine, so you can manage this just as any file in your repository. Whereas in Vagrant, you need to have a dedicated, say, I would say for experience, you have a dedicated repository where you build your images on demand. So you can also create your images on the fly at runtime. I mean, before you really spin up your tests, and this is what we actually do. We have like a base image which contains Java, Python, whatever we need for environment. But then we are adding, so we build our product, our DSC from scratch, from the source code, and we add it to this to the image. So we get another image, which we Docker image, right? And we then use that image for really running tests.
But that's the extent to which you use Docker. Because, you know, Docker folks will hear that and say, oh, well, you know, if you're already doing that, you might as well, you know, use Docker all the way through broader scale deployment. Well, you're kind of a different piece, but someone like us, the next natural step for the Docker people might say, you know, you do your whole Cassandra cluster way out to production.
Yeah, you can do that. I mean, we run our test like that, and this is like a first phase. Now you can build your continuous integration deployment on top of that. So then the next stage would be, okay, we have like a DSC version, which we want to test further or deploy. We can then make real image for deployment, for staging, and so on, and then push that to further in on the line. So it doesn't. It's not really this or that, so you can really build on top of it. We use Docker here to isolate our test workers from each other and let them run on the same physical machine. This was. At the moment, no. Yeah, at the moment, no. We have some experiments with Docker images, and some customers are asking for some, let's say, know-how about Docker images and how to run DSC inside Docker containers. But yeah. That's it. We don't have official images we publish on, say, Docker registry or so. Since we, so depending on the test, we have a lot of tests where we just spin on one node, right, to check some basic functionalities. And then you have like Docker container is just one process, so it's like one process per node. In some situation, we like three node cluster. In that particular scenario, we actually start three processes. And of course, if your machine has like 24 cores, you have to a bit worry about it. So you have to figure out what is the optimal value. You should also not do too much, because then you're gonna put your CPU on 100%, and then you're gonna start having some issues with latencies, with some effects which are really strange. Yeah. So our experience is to keep CPU on 80%, and we are good. Which means that if we have like 24 core machines, and then we spin up like 17 workers, that's our value. We are satisfied so far. Yeah, we can catch up on the coffee break. Anybody who wants to ask me something more, we can discuss later. Thank you.